If it's possible for you to do so, we want you to take your Bibles down and follow with me again as we turn to Acts chapter 9. I'm going to begin reading at verse 1 through 6 and then verses 17 through 19. Listen to the Word of God or follow along in your Bible if you will. And Saul, yet breathing out threatenings and slaughter against the disciples of the Lord, went unto the high priest and desired of him letters to Damascus to the synagogue, that if he found any of this way, whether they were men or women, he might bring them bound unto Jerusalem. And as he journeyed, he came near Damascus, and suddenly there shined round about him a light from heaven. And he fell to the earth and heard a voice saying unto him, Saul, Saul, why persecutest thou me? And he said, Who art thou, Lord? And the Lord said, I am Jesus, whom thou persecutest. It is hard for thee to kick against the pricks. And he, trembling and astonished, said, Lord, what wilt thou have me to do? And the Lord said unto him, Arise and go into the city, and it shall be told thee what thou must do. Then verse 17, And Ananias went his way, and entered into the house, and putting his hands on him, said, Brother Saul, the Lord, even Jesus, that appeared unto thee in the way as thou camest, has sent me, that thou mightest receive thy sight, and be filled with the Holy Ghost. And immediately there fell from his eyes as it had been scales, and he received sight forthwith, and arose, and was baptized. And when he had received meat, he was strengthened. Then was Saul certain days with the disciples which were at Damascus, and straightway he preached Christ in the synagogues, that he is the Son of God. Today we're going to look again at the Apostle Paul, and we're going to see here the rebellion that was in him that has to be broken, because it's the same kind of rebellion that's in the heart of every individual. Look with me, if you will, at verse 1 of chapter 9. And Saul, yet breathing out threatenings and slaughter against the disciples of the Lord, went unto the high priest, and desired of him letters to Damascus, to the synagogues, that if he found any of this way, whether they were men or women, he might bring them bound unto Jerusalem. Now what do we have here? Here we have the rebellion of the Apostle Paul, and it's also the rebellion of every individual that's without the Lord Jesus Christ. The reason some of you listening to me now are not saved yet is because of the fact you have not surrendered unto the Lord God of heaven. You see, you want your own way. And I'll tell you right now, when we get converted, our way is swallowed up in the way of Christ. And we become the slave of the Lord Jesus Christ. And a slave has no will of his own. And we need to understand that. Salvation consists of the unconditional surrender of the individual unto the power and authority and claims of the Lord Jesus Christ. And when we get converted, this is what happens. Our body becomes a temple of the Holy Spirit, and we find the Holy Spirit takes up his dwelling place in us. And at the same time, what takes place is this. We are translated from the kingdom of Satan, which is the kingdom of darkness, into the kingdom of God's dear Son, which is the Lord Jesus Christ. Now I'm going to ask you a question. Do you know what I'm talking about? Have you ever been translated out of the kingdom of Satan? I know many of you have made a profession, but I want to ask you a question. Is that profession genuine with you? Are you still doing the same things you did before you got saved? Maybe not as much, but still involved in them? My friend, if that be true, there's something wrong with your profession of faith. You see, every individual outside of the Lord Jesus Christ is a religious sinner, but every individual also is an unsaved individual. Now, the Apostle Paul had a great deal of religion. Now, how do you know, preacher? Well, if you'll turn with me to Philippians chapter 3, we see it set forth where the Apostle Paul tells us of his situation. The book of Philippians in chapter 3, and I believe this is where Paul was crying unto the Lord in those 3 days that he was being dealt with, and the Lord was showing him that all his religion was nothing. Because we find in Philippians chapter 3, we read these words, For we are the circumcision, which worship God in spirit, and rejoice in Christ Jesus, and have no confidence in the flesh, though I might also have confidence in the flesh. If any man thinketh that he hath whereof he might trust in the flesh, I the more. Circumcised the 8th day of the stock of Israel, of the tribe of Benjamin, and Hebrew of the Hebrew, as touching the law, a Pharisee, concerning zeal, persecuting the church, touching the righteousness which is in the law, blameless. But what things were gained to me, those I counted loss for Christ. Yea, doubtless, and I count all things but loss for the excellency of the knowledge of Christ Jesus my Lord, for whom I have suffered the loss of all things, and do count them but dung, that I might win Christ, and be found in him, not having mine own righteousness, which is of the law, but that which is through the faith of Christ, the righteousness which is of God by faith. You see the change there? The Apostle Paul was a Pharisee of the Pharisees. He was as religious as he could be. But I'll tell you right now, he was in the midst of a fourfold rebellion. And every individual outside of the Lord Jesus Christ is in the same category. Number one, the Apostle Paul was in rebellion against God's person. He hated the Lord Jesus Christ, because we found in verse 2, if he found any of this way, whether they might were men and women, he might bring them unto Jerusalem. Now, what was the purpose of it? That they might be chastised and killed. And Paul put his hand to it because he was a religious individual, but at the same time, he hated the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, someone might say, well, preacher, I don't hate the Lord Jesus Christ. You don't? Then, my friend, I invite you to turn with me, if you will, to the book of Romans, and we find in chapter 3 the description of every unsaved individual before they get converted. Listen to what it says in verse 12. They are all gone out of the way. They are together become unprofitable. There is none that doeth good. No, not one. Their throat is an open sepulchre. With their tongues they have used deceit. The poison of asps is under their lips, whose mouth is full of cursing and bitterness. Their feet are swift to shed blood. Destruction and misery are in their ways, and the way of peace have they not known. There is no fear of God before their eyes. And my friend, that was the condition of the Apostle Paul. He was absolutely dead set that he was right and the really believers were really wrong. And how many people are like that today? My friend, I want to tell you right now, when you argue with the Word of God, you're arguing with God. And that's what individuals do. And people today would have you believe that it's all right to believe parts of the Word of God. But my friend, I'm going to tell you right now, you've got to believe all of it or else you'll die and go to hell. No man can confess Jesus as Lord but by the Holy Ghost. And when the Holy Ghost gets a hold of an individual, I'll tell you right now, that rebellion is broken. Now someone might say, well now, Pastor, am I in rebellion today? Yes, you are. Let me prove it to you again, if I may. In Romans chapter 8, verse 5 through 8, these words, listen to it. For they that are after the flesh do mind the things of the flesh, but they that are after the Spirit, the things of the Spirit. For to be carnally minded is death, but to be spiritually minded is life and peace. Because the carnal mind is enmity against God, it is not subject to the law of God, neither indeed can be. So then they that are in the flesh cannot please God. But ye are not in the flesh, but in the Spirit, if so be that the Spirit of God dwell in you. Now if any man have not the Spirit of God, he is none of his. Now let me ask you a question. Where does that put you at this hour? Are you in rebellion, like the Apostle Paul, against the person of the Lord God of heaven? You see, Paul didn't want the Lord God of heaven to rule over him. And every sinner is in that category until the Holy Spirit breaks that rebellion. The second thing about Paul was this. It was not only rebellion against God's person, but there was also rebellion against God's provision. You see, Paul was steeped in religion. He was a Pharisee of the Pharisee, and we find, what are you talking about? He was a number one man in the Sanhedrin, and I'll tell you right now, Paul knew the law. Paul lived by the law. And like he said in Philippians, touching the law, the righteousness of the law, he was blameless. In other words, he was keeping all the law of God as much as he could. And yet, he was absolutely wrong. And when the Holy Spirit of God comes upon the heart of a sinner, the first thing that what happens is this. Every sinner usually has to unlearn what they have learned with regard to religion. How sad it is, but how true it is, because you see, when God sets out to save a sinner, he strips that individual of everything that individual has. His self-righteousness is gone, his rebellion is gone, I'll tell you right now, and everything else is gone. He stands before God, a guilty, lost, helpless, hopeless, hapless sinner, wondering if the Lord God of heaven would ever save him, not knowing whether he will or not, but all he can do is sue for mercy and cry unto the Lord, God be merciful to me, the sinner. And my friend, this is what happened to the Apostle Paul, and this is what's going to happen to you if you ever get converted, or it has happened to you if you ever have been truly converted. Now, why do I tell you this? Because salvation is all of God, and it's all of grace. Now, the Apostle Paul, and like every individual, wants to have a hand in their salvation. This is why it is so sad when individuals get up there and they say, well, now, Jesus Christ did all that he could for you, and now the rest is up to you. You see, my friend, that's works. That's not salvation, because we are saved by grace through faith, that not of ourselves. It's the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus unto good works, which God hath before ordained that we should walk in them. Now a sinner rebels against God's provision, because every sinner would like to have a hand in his salvation. My friend, it can't be done. Salvation is all of God, and it's absolutely all of grace. And that means there's no works whatever. Now hold your seat as I give you this truth, if I may. The very repentance that God requires of us, and the very faith that God requires of us, is given to us by the Lord God of heaven. Repentance is given to us in Acts chapter 11 and verse 18. Then we find when they heard that the Gentiles had received Christ, what did they do? They rejoiced, and we find very clearly, when they heard these things, they held their peace and glorified God, saying, then hath God also to the Gentiles granted repentance unto life. And then we find very clearly, how are we saved? We are saved by salvation through grace, absolute, positive, and eternal grace. And my friend, when an individual hears the gospel, the rebellion rises up in them against God's person, and then it rises up against God's provision. Because as I said before, many people want to have a hand in their salvation. Many also will not accept the reality that there has to be the shedding of blood for them to be saved. How many people have said today, I don't want that kind of bloody religion, and that's becoming very popular across America at this hour. And it's so sad, because these poor individuals will die and go to hell, because without the shedding of blood, there is no remission. And it's by the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ that we are saved, because the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ cleanses from all sin, and nothing else does. Now let me stop again. Do you know what I'm talking about? Oh, my friend, today, the third thing about Paul's rebellion was this. It was a rebellion against God's purpose. When God saves an individual, I'll tell you right now, that individual is completely changed. There's a change of position, there's a change of nature, and there's also a change of behavior. The change of position is this. When God sets out and saves a sinner, what does he do? He translates us out of the kingdom of darkness into the kingdom of God's dear Son, which is the Lord Jesus Christ. And so, the position is this. We are changed from a sinner into a saint. Then also, there's not only a change of position, we are translated out of the kingdom of darkness into the kingdom of God's dear Son, but then there's also a change in our nature. Now you say, preacher, what in the world are you talking about? Well, let me give you a verse of scripture or two, if I may. And you turn to me, if you can, in your Bibles, to the book of 2 Peter. And I want you to notice what Peter tells us with regard to the change of our nature. In 2 Peter chapter 1, and we find very clearly, according as his divine power has given unto us all things that pertain unto life and godliness through the knowledge of him that hath called us to glory and virtue. Now listen to these words. Whereby are given unto us exceeding great and precious promises, that by these you might be partakers of the divine nature, having escaped the corruption that is in the world through lust. Here you have the change of position. Here you also have the change of nature. The nature of man today is rebellion against the Lord God of heaven. The nature of man today is to live and die and have a good time and not worry about anything else but having a good time. And that's to like the Epicureans, you know. We eat, drink, and be merry, for tomorrow we die. But people today are forgetting that there's a God they're going to face one of these days. Now what happens also? There's not only the rebellion against God's person, against God's provision, against God's purpose, and then we find also there's a rebellion against God's preacher. Why was the Apostle Paul so angry, breathing out threatening and slaughter against the disciples of the Lord? You see, here we find the Apostle Paul was being dealt with, and I'll tell you right now, his rebellion was against God's preachers, because he felt sure that those that were preaching the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ were absolutely wrong. And the rebellion was in his heart, and I'll tell you right now, he could not get at God, so he went after God's preachers. And we notice, breathing out threatenings and slaughter against the disciples of the Lord. And it didn't make any difference who it was. because every individual that ever gets saved in some way is a preacher of the Lord God of Heaven. You see, we're left here on this earth to share with individuals what the Lord God of Heaven has done for us personally. And I hope and pray that you're doing that. Now, the Apostle Paul was absolutely filled with rebellion. He had already committed people to prison, and some of them had been put to death by his approval. And Stephen was one of them, because he held the coats while they did what? They stoned Stephen, and setting forth again the rebellion that was in the heart of the Apostle Paul against God's preachers. Now that happens today. Are you listening? If a preacher is preaching the truth of God, there's one of two things that are going to happen. They're either going to love him or they're going to hate him. And if they hate him, they're going to do everything they can to try to destroy his character and his integrity and everything like that. But you know, one marvelous thing of this, we are kept by the power of God through faith unto salvation, ready to be revealed in the last time. Now I want you to notice, when God sets out to save a sinner, what does he do? He breaks the rebellion of that sinner. If you're listening to me at this hour and you're unsaved, my friend, I'll tell you right now, this is your category. You are in rebellion against the person of the Lord God of Heaven, because he's a sovereign God and you want to have your own way. And when God sets out to save you, you're not going to have your own way. Then also you're in rebellion against God's provision, which is salvation by grace and also by blood redemption. And people today don't want to hear that. Then we find there's a third thing. There's also the rebellion against God's purpose. Because I've said it before, I'm going to say it again. Every individual will do everything he can to keep from being saved. And the Apostle Paul is a classic example of it. He was breathing out threatening and slaughter against the disciples of the Lord. And he was bound and determined to do one thing. He would get rid of every one of them if it was possible. You see, there was a rebellion against God's purpose. And then we find also there was a rebellion against God's preachers, because he breathing out threatenings and slaughter against the disciples of the Lord. And what did he do? He got the permission to the high priest to go to Damascus and find these people and bring them bound to Jerusalem that they might be killed. And we find an individual today without Christ, when the gospel goes home to the heart of that person, I'll tell you right now, these four things will take place. The rebellion against the preacher, and I'll tell you right now, all that rebellion has to be broken. Now let me close, because my time is just about gone. Do you know the Lord Jesus Christ today? Are you still in rebellion against the truth of God? If you are, my friend, you need to repent and sue for mercy on the basis that Christ died for sinners, and you're the sinner. And remember, only the blood of Christ can save you. My hope is that something has been said, that the Holy Spirit of God will stir your heart and bring you to Christ if you don't know him, and if you do know him, that you will live for him more than ever before. Until we meet again, this is Pastor Nortier of the Mercies of God saying goodbye, and oh, may the Lord spare you before it's too late.